family.
Sarnetta, subscribe to Sarnetta. I was on the couch watching Sarnetta. Peace to the Netches, peace to the prophets. He brought them all together, he's the Don King of knowledge. Learning information you cannot get from a college. Never knew a day it would be cool to be conscious. I was on the topic, loving the debates. Now we got the conferences to serve another plate, so you can get your food for thought and enjoy the pleasure. Red, black, and green, I'm on the way up to the lecture. It's all for the better, knowledge is a treasure. A legend to the game, the one and only Sarnetta.
We do it for the people, we do it for the fam. Sarnetta Studios, Black News 102. Special shout out to the HOK. The house of consciousness is all the same. We do it for the people, we do it for the fam. Sarnetta Studios, Black News 102. Special shout out to the HOK. The house of consciousness is all the same.
Do it for the people. Sarnetta TV. We do it for the people.
And Black Power family, welcome to another Sarnetta TV House of Consciousness production. As you can see, we have the Grand Master, the return of the Master, Dr. Leonard Jeffries. And of course, right beside him, we have my brother, friend, Dr. Reggie in the building as well. I want to say thank you, my brother Reggie, for being persistent in getting Dr. Leonard Jeffries to the House of Consciousness to bless the studio. I definitely appreciate both of you brothers. Of course, my elder, Dr. Jeffries. We have so much wisdom right here in this building right now, in the house. And I'm going to just pass the mic to my brother, Dr. Reggie. See, let him open up.
So, I am so excited. I met Dr. Jeffries more than 33, 34 years ago. When I met Dr. Jeffries was younger than I am now. Could you believe that, Doc? With a basketball in his hand, right. Ready to take anybody on the court.
That's right. Right? And did take him up to the gym in City College. And sometimes I beat him so bad, they said, Dr. J, don't tell nobody about it.
And then come back and lead Black Studies departments. And then, see, in this course, in this mighty walk and mighty journey, people meet lots of people. And here's Dr. Leonard Jeffries with a young Sarnetta looking like his son. Right. And so myself and Sarnetta is actually my elder. We've been part of the activist revolution for many, 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 many years. We're talking 30, 34, 35, 36 years. So we didn't just get out of nowhere. Right. We didn't just drop out of here, even though we have been quiet. Like, how could I speak when there's a Dr. John Henry Clark room and Dr. Ben? Dr. Leonard Jeffries can't even speak when Dr. John Henry Clark is in the room. He has to wait. We have to wait our turns. Now Dr. Jeffries is the age of John Henry Clark, closing in on those age when we knew Dr. John Henry Clark when he was on fire.
80 minus 1.
80 minus 1, right. Is your age.
In January, I will hit 79. So in a few weeks, I'll be 80 minus 1.
And we're going to be celebrating Dr. Ben's birthday, Dr. Clark's birthday.
And then in the middle of the month, they'll be celebrating Dr. J.
Dr. Jeffy. And yeah. then, so we have, and when was your anniversary?
Sunday, November the 29th was my, the end of my 50th anniversary. So we start now on 51. So we're going to start another 50, a run of 50 years.
So in the heart, in this story, this great Mighty Walk, you have Dr. Jeffries and his queen, Dr. Rosalind Jeffries, married for 50 plus years, going to Africa for 50 plus years as a couple.
Right. Actually, my wife is a pioneer. She's a real queen mother in all the aspects of the queen mother. She began her great and mighty walk in 1960 when the African nations were just bursting forth with independence. She was actually spent the summer in the villages in Nigeria in 1960 before Nigeria was independent. They got their independence in October 1960. She was there in June, July, and August. So that she's a pioneer and wanting to have this African consciousness as a part of her life. And that same program that a brother who had a church in Harlem, a Reverend James H. Robinson, who was a friend of Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, had gone to Lincoln University with him. And that same year, I got a relationship with Reverend Robinson. I met him at college. I went back to Lafayette College for a football weekend. And here was, when I walked into the manse, that's the where the chaplain lives, a white man sitting there, the chaplain, was sitting there with a black man. And as soon as I walked into the door, the white man said, "That's the man for your program." And the rest is history. In other words, I met Reverend Robinson. I carried his bag across the campus when he spoke at the chapel to 1,500 white folks, deans and students, etc. And his message was about Africa and the challenge of Africa and what you have to do to be a part of it. And I'm sitting there with tears of joy. I mean, I knew he wasn't talking to the 1,500 white boys. He was talking to me. And our spiritual contact took place then. He became a father to me, a father of the movement, a father of the consciousness. And so that was November 1960. I'd just come back from Europe. And I had written in October 1960, a closer look at the world. In other words, when I went to Europe, my mind was blown. I had an American education. And I knew that it wasn't sufficient, but once I went to Europe, I realized it was a miseducation of the worst kind. It wasn't preparing you for nothing. And so I actually wrote an article in the college newspaper, A Closer Look at the World, that you're being educated to become a niche in the corporate structure. You're being educated in the Ivy League syndrome, the Tweedy jacket syndrome, a khaki pants syndrome. So I actually wrote an article in October denouncing the education that I had and saying that the European experience exploded my world and exploded my consciousness. And the important thing was that I've met Africa in Europe. But the African that I met in Europe was not, he looked African. He had his bushy hair. He had a nice fat behind. He was melanized. But when I ran up to him, because I was studying in Switzerland, international affairs, and I ran up to black people because I needed some love. I said, "Brother, who are you? Where are you from?" And he looked at me. And
when you mean he, you mean he and she.
He and she. I ran up to them, and what their response was, "Je suis français." I'm French. And I'm looking at a black man and woman that's as black as the ace of spades, and but they are now expressing to me sincerely that they are French. So it got so discouraging after a time because Switzerland is so white, I'm looking for some black love. And so since I couldn't get it with the dark ones like myself, I said, maybe I could find some love with one of these light folks walking around here, like my natural brother, my beautiful brother, younger brother, Master Sensei Marlon, who was in the military in Europe and Germany. And so here we are, the Jeffries boys, meeting in Europe. So I said, maybe I could find some love with some of these light folks. So I ran after them. And to my shock, I got the same response. Je suis français. They were from Guadeloupe in the Caribbean. Martinique in the Caribbean.
And so,
je suis français means I'm French.
Okay, we can continue.
So it was clear that the mind of Africa was not being developed for African purposes or African people. The mind of Africa was being developed to serve the Europeans, not in the old colonial dimension, but in what we call neo-colonialism, the new colonialism.
And while you were in...
Hold on, yes. With that, that's going to lead us into the opening before he go in, because he's going to go in.
Okay.
So we should take it right there so we can open up and then have Dr. J really go in.
So to understand... No, we weren't. The only thing is I was going to ask Dr. Jeffries, when you was having this experience in Europe, it wasn't in English. It was in French, right?
Oui, bien sûr. Je parle très bien le français, presque comme le français. En effet, mes études de doctorat étaient faites dans la langue française.
So, yes. So, and you said,
yes, I said, sure. It was a great experience because I had a chance to use my French and expand my mind. And so people were saying, well, did you fall in love with the French people? I said, no. I fell in love with Africans who are trying to find their Africanness. And they happen to come out of the French-speaking tradition. And one of the most important of those people was a brother-sister leadership in a queen mother and a king, Pharaoh. And that person was... The family was the Diops, D-I-O-P.
Okay, so we.
And then people will say, "Wait a minute, Dr. J, are you talking about Shekanta Diop?" No, I'm talking about those who laid the foundation for him, those who built the platform for him, those who he loved to death. That's Madame Diop and her husband Alioune Diop.
So now. We're going to segue into one of our other master teachers who we all defer to. They're twin giants. There's Dr. John Henry Clark, and there's Dr. Joseph Ben Jochanan. And on top of them was Dr. John Jackson, who you'll talk about, who taught in your classroom.
We're talking about a brotherhood of light. Africans who tapped into this knowledge. And they didn't go at each other. They didn't puff themselves up and saying, I'm better than you. They said, brother, you got to come into the light too. And then you see this light, it's a glow that'll transform you. And so when Dr. Clark had it, he got it from others who had the light. Schomburg, Arthur Schomburg, Arturo Schomburg, who had a collection of the African light, the books, the knowledge. And then it was so great, personally collected by him, that it becomes the basis for the most significant research institution on Black history, the Schomburg Center in the heart of Harlem. So it was brothers like, elder brothers like Schomburg, who told Dr. Clark, step into the light, brother. Run and get the light. And Dr. Clark was a little shocked because he said, wait a minute, where can I find this light? He said, go into European history. And Dr. Clark said, what? Go into European history and you will find your history as the missing pages of Europe. And so that speaks to me because I went to Europe to study international affairs. But what I found was Africa in its deepest dimension, meeting Alioune Diop and his wife, Madame Diop, who had set up a research institute, a library, a publishing house, a cafe where people could meet and dialogue and look at this whole question of the war against African peoples and the whole question of the rise of African peoples, the renaissance of African peoples. And so people say, well, you ain't got nothing in Europe. You ain't lost nothing in Europe. But you can find your mind in Europe, because all of the great achievements of African peoples have been celebrated by the Europeans, and they're in their greatest institutions. If you took out the treasures of Africa out of the British Museum, notably one of the greatest museums in the history of the world, if you took the treasures out of the British Museum, it wouldn't be worthy of being called a global museum. Because the Nile Valley tapestries are there, the sculptures are there, the papyri are there. The work of later Africans, the Dogon work, 300 tablets, metalwork with history that was in Benin City that graced the palace area and the center of Benin City. They were stripped out of Africa, and they weren't thrown away because they were represented as savage people. They were given a place of honor in the British Museum. You go into the British Museum and you see the Rhind, R-H-I-N-D, papyrus. It is given the highest place of any written literature in the British Museum.
That is the mathematical
papyrus. It is the mathematical papyrus that the Africans left as part of legacy in the Nile Valley. That is in the great work of Cheikh Anta Diop and his great masterwork, Civilization or Barbarism.
So we're going to tie all this up together with what we're doing today, which is intellectual warfare. Or titled Intellectual Warfare, because it's a whole new generation of people that have to take their positions in this fight. Otherwise, other people will be able to tell African people their story without us understanding our story. And so Dr. John Henry Clark told us a very, very valuable lesson. And wove together, like Dr. Jeffries wove together his generation. John Henry Clark was a glue for a whole nother generation. Chancellor Williams, John Jackson. So we're going to introduce a very important lecture that is told to all of us by Dr. John Henry Clark. You ready, Dr. Jeffries?
How long is it? Because there's a whole lot of illusions about Africa's relationship with other people in the world. There's a whole lot of illusion about our relationship to the religions in the world. And these belief systems that had its origin in Africa, all of them, and there is no exception, turned on African people. I said there is no exception. Everything that was brought into this continent, everything, every idea, every so-called religion, was meant to dominate and to control. The Arabs had no illusions about it. The Europeans had no illusions about it. You were the ones with the illusions. Now, Africa has always and still is the prize for the whole world. We as a people have always been the world's richest people, culturally rich, mineral rich. We have always been the prize because we have always had and still have something that other people won't, think they can't do without, and don't care to pay for. Because we have always been the prize, we have been under siege for over 3,000 years. Nothing that ever brought into Africa from the outside was meant to do the African any good. That means all other religions. Islam was the handmaiden of Arab imperialism. Christianity was the handmaiden of European imperialism. The Hebrew faith was the handmaiden of a concept called the chosen people. Now, if God is kind and God is merciful and God has no stepchildren, he won't choose one over the other. And to say he chose some people, you're making him a bigot. I'm saying that African belief systems, properly understood, is 10 times better than Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And better for the African. So you might have some romance with one of these religions. I have no romance with any of them. I have a romance with reality and truth.
and the chips can fall where they may after I tell it. As for friends, you have had no friends. When they discovered you, they began to prey on you. Now let's look at our relationship with Western Asia, mistakenly called the Middle East. I'm saying we need to take a good look at ourselves. I'm not talking about burning churches. I'm not talking about getting rid of religions. Understand me well. I am saying that every single thing that touches your life, religious, socially, and politically, must be an instrument of your liberation, or you must throw it into the ash can of history. Amen. Develop a liberation Islam.
Yes.
And if you develop a liberation Islam, you'd have to turn on the supreme slave traders who were in the slave trade 1,000 years before the Europeans, the Arabs. Yes. And most brothers who think they're Muslims are merely Arabists. Forerunners, vanguards of Arab propaganda. The Arabs are not above joining the Jews against black people. In America, they're already doing it in Detroit. In America, they're already doing it in real estate. You got some dewy-eyed thing that you got a friend. I still ask you to look at that mirror. And if nothing's staring back at you is friendly, then you've got no friend. You don't have to argue about the shades of color. So far as you're concerned, once you establish he was not a woman, he was not a Greek, your conversation is over. Now, if somebody else want to argue about his shade, well, that's their problem. Then if you got a problem with color, then you got a problem with your mother and your father. You have insulted your mother and your father if you don't like what they gave you. I wear mine like a badge of honor. I dig it. I wear it well.
All right. Love it.
I'm saying, in closing, and I am closing, that what you have to do is take a holistic look. Now that, not only at your position in the world, but your potential in the world. You have to learn how to convert everything into an instrument of liberation or leave it alone. You have to realize there were no Greek fraternities and sororities until they were introduced to secret African societies. People get all dewy-eyed over something that was imposed on them in order to control them without understanding that. That's another imperial effort. So it bothers me. And although I have good personal friends who are Muslim, not a single Muslim scholar have dealt with that 1,000 years of African independence before slavery and how the Arabs from the north systematically destroyed these nations. They actually, it did not occur. 1591, from Morocco, an army was launched against these great independent nations in inner West Africa. These were great states, and because of the poor communication between African and African, there was enough armies in these states to march down to the coast and to drive every slave trader into the sea. But the communication between African and African was so poor. Even today, the East Africa is not too clear about what's happening in West Africa. And nobody knows what's happening in North Africa because the conspiracy to hold on to Africa is happening in South Africa and in North Africa. So the whites in South Africa are willing to play a part, and the pseudo-whites in North Africa are willing to play a part. In all this world, you have no friends. But if there are a billion of you on the face of this earth scattered all over the world, what do you need with a friend other than yourself?
We must free our minds from all forms of foreign influence on our mind, and we must approach Africa pure and simple. I do not think that there is a religious solution for Africa irrespective of the religion. I think there's a cultural and a political solution. And many of the brothers who think they are Muslims or Arabists and apologizers for Arabism. If you said that, do you have a problem? Yes, I have a problem with the Christians too, only a bigger problem.
I would like to add a clarification I think my elder brother was making, which I wish to endorse. What Dr. Clark is saying, there is nothing in an Arabic name that has anything to do with Islam. What happened is, since Islam came up in an Arabic context in the desert, it reflects an Arabic position. For instance, most African culture has a base with the mother. You inherit from your mother. Islam, on the other hand, being Arabic, coming from the desert, is a male dominated culture. You inherit from your father. That is an African, in spite of the fact that Hadsat Kubad ibn Radat, you may know him as Bilal, impacted on Islam and became its first head of the embassies, even though he was asked to be the spiritual leader 3 times by Abu Bakr, Umar the Great, and the Prophet himself. What has happened? Like all religions, people know the rituals and the dogmas, but ignore the historical development. Under Islam, Africa was first enslaved and then extended to the European. Islam enslaved Africa in 18 AH after the Hijra, equivalent to 640 of the Common Era. It is Islam who started to deliver Africans to the Europeans that caused the Europeans to enslave Africans from 1509.
Okay.
Woo! That's the grandmaster teachers right there, boy.
So we're looking at, of course, a brothership between Dr. Ben and Dr. Clark, an extension of John Jackson and John G. Jackson and Chancellor Williams and Arthur Schomburg and George G.M. James and the Harlem History Club and in the emergence of the Pan-African unions and other scholars, African scholars in Europe, Chacante Diops, Alion Diops, and we have scholars in Europe, Professor Edward Scobie, author of Black Britannica, right?
Dr. Theophilo Banga.
Dr. Theophilo Banga from the Congo, right? So we have an emergence of intellectual warriors. And then on our side, we have Dr. Jacob Carruthers and Dr. Milana Karenga. And
before Dr. Jacob Carruthers and Dr. Milana Karenga, Dr. Clark was referring to 3,000 years of domination, war against African peoples. And when he uses that terminology, he's referring to... But his other great work is the rebirth of African civilization. So what I want to be able to contribute to our discussion, and hopefully I'll get a chance to come back and share the information, because this is just an appetizer in reference to Dr. J. The experience that I've been blessed to have is so enormous that I couldn't even think of collapsing it into one period or one process.
So 1 second. Listen, Black family, Sarnetta and Sarnetta... Studios is going to give Dr. Jeffries a donation for what he can in this period while he's paying all the bills for the conferences and stuff like that and getting it organized. So Sarnetta is short. However, Dr. Leonard Jeffries has a GoFundMe. It is www.gofundme.com /LeonardJeffries. LeonardJeffries. So it's www.gofundme.
Better than that. Here, write it on here.
I will. So I will. And I'll say it now, and then we'll take another break. But it is www.gofundme.com/LeonardJeffries. Now, some of you have not had the opportunity to have 30 years of an experience with you, like myself, right? But want to contribute.
Am I that old, Reggie? And you're getting that old. We're talking about 30 years. Wow.
I knew you when you was my age, right? So, yes. So they're not, many people are not going to have that experience of getting beat up. It wasn't easy, Dr. J.
It was a beating of love and affection.
Right. So
to try to write the course.
That's exactly right. So, Dr. Leonard Jeffries builds scholars. That's what he does. He builds people. They all build people equipped for this intellectual warfare.
Scholars and leaders that are committed to their people and are not just committed to themselves and to what I call achieving Negro-ness. Scholars who are willing to sacrifice it all because they're making this enormous contribution to the upliftment of the chosen people of the universe. So that we need the help. Because those of us who have made a commitment to stay the African course and to continue to struggle for the African mind are not going to get the funding. There's going to be no grants coming in from the MacArthur Foundation and all these other things. Those grants will go to Skip the Truth, Henry's.
But that's not exactly true, because we're going to get to that. But first, remember, GoFundMe.com/LeonardJeffries, right? But this will be missed in our conversation. I know it will, right? The first major grant that was given to black folks for black folks was a grant by the Ford Foundation to the Kente Project?
Rockefeller
Foundation.
Sorry. Rockefeller Foundation gave me a grant to complete my research in the field for the PhD.
Yes.
Ford Foundation contributed a fellowship to Columbia University that allowed me to get the master's in African studies. Mm-hmm. Within that period of time, talking about 62, 63, you're talking about the grant from Rockefeller 65. In 69, I met Alex Haley. And Alex Haley had this project of linking our people back to Africa, which became Roots, Roots the book and Roots the film. I was Alex's major partner on both of those endeavors. And how do we know that, Dr. J? Where's the proof? The proof is not only in the pudding, it's in the money. Show me the money, Dr. J. Well, we had $500,000 grant from the Carnegie Corporation. Alex met me in 61. We became friends in 69. We became friends in 70. In 71, he asked me to help him get funding for his great project. And we were able, because Carnegie Corporation was interested. And so we were able to connect with Carnegie Corporation. They were giving $500,000 grants out to different associations and people. But Alex was an individual. They couldn't give $500,000 grant to him. He had nothing to hang it on. There has to be fiscal responsibility. There has to be accountability. So because of his relationship with me, we were able to accept the grant to help Alex Haley come up with his great work and his great project, the book particularly, by having that grant handled by from the Carnegie Corporation, handled by the San Jose University Foundation. So I actually put the funding under Alex Haley's roots through the Carnegie Foundation because he had no money. He didn't have a place to stay. He was staying with his girlfriend in San Francisco. He was hiding his car off the streets of San Francisco, his little convertible Volkswagen.
So his brothership.
But the brother relationship that we developed proved so beneficial. Because we were able then to bring on board other scholars who were able to contribute to what Alex Haley had opened the window on. And then other scholars began to rush in. Instead of going through the window, they blasted in a door into linking African peoples to themselves and linking African peoples to the motherland, Africa. Roots did not come out of scholarship of a scholar. Roots came out of a non-scholar writer who did not graduate from college. His other brothers graduated. One had an engineering architecture degree. One was an attorney. That's his older brother, George. Alex did not graduate, and he went into in college. He went into the Coast Guard. His parents were college graduates.
Okay, so we can do a whole show on Dr. Leonard Jeffries and Roots, the hidden story of the making of Roots.
That's right.
And we can also, Dr. Jeffries has not revealed, and we'll come back to it when we start maybe talking about slavery, that it was you, Dr. Jeffries, that took him to Jufere.
Well, he went to Jufere before I made the contact with him. And he met this brother, Bakary Sadibi, who's the archivist for the Gambia. And Bakary Sadibi was able to take him to Jufere. However, when he needed to have that historical moment put on tape, he redid the return to Jufere. And that was done in the 70s. I went with him at that point. There was 200 of us that went. I paid my way because I didn't want to go through Europe because I'm setting up the Black Studies Department at Citi. So I met him in Senegal, and we had meetings with the president of Senegal. I was one of his interpreter. And then we went on to the Gambia and met with the president of the Gambia. And then with the 200 writers and newspaper people from around the world and some scholars, we went to redo the visit of Jufere.
So these are, at one point, but we need your support. Definitely, Dr. Jeffries carries a heavy load. He has an incredible archive that contains the archive of his work, his wife's work, Professor Scobie's work, and file cabinets of Black Studies curriculum and materials and papers around the world. And so, look, if you do have some money, and if you do want to make a commitment, please go to GoFundMe.com/Leonard Jeffries. And Dr. Jeffries, you do receive money, so it's not like someone's setting up a GoFundMe and you don't get a check.
Well, the GoFundMe has worked, and we also have set up a foundation, and so we're expanding our reach out to our community. Because we're not going to be funded by the large money sources because they know that the work that we're doing is turning the history upside right, that African people are not the doormats of history, are not lesser than. African peoples are the foundation of the human family. And so that has been documented, scientific research, and we are on the cutting edge of putting that scientific research in the hands of our people.
So Sarnetta has a question, and then we don't want to take any of the power and strength away from the words of Dr. John Henry Clark and Dr. Yosef Benjo Cannon when it talks about Africa has no friends and our intellectual warfare. So Sarnetta, what's your question to Dr. Jeffries?
Yes, it's a pleasure. Dr. Jeffries, the up-and-coming young people, the young scholars who are following in the footsteps of Dr. Jeffries, Dr. Clark, Dr. Clark, and Dr. Ben. You have a team out there who is called the Amun-Ra Squad, group of young brothers, powerful brothers. You also have brothers out there like Dr. Reggie. I'm glad he came on board. You have brothers out there like Brother Polite. And the list goes on and on. Ngozi. Brother Infadiji, he who's not a young buck, but he's out there, the elders.
Yeah, Booker T. Coleman.
Booker T. Coleman and many others. I'm talking about mainly the young people that's coming up, that's carrying this torch now. They are When I say fighting up against certain curriculums, I'm not talking about physical. I'm talking about to maintain our struggle and to keeping it on Africa, like the Amon Ra Squad. They are going up against organizations like Muslims that's coming in trying to say that, you know, they are going up against Hebrew Israelites that are coming in trying to attack ancient Egypt and Africa and saying that we are not African people and we are all Hebrew Israelites. Let me ask you, in your upbringing, have you, Dr. Clark, or any of the scholars in your surroundings ever came up against people like the Hebrew Israelites or the Muslims that tried to come at y'all saying, we are not African, we are not Hebrews, I mean, we are Hebrew Israelites, it started with us?
Before he does that, right, yes. I want to preface it. In Dr. Jeffrey's generation, it wasn't about black folks fighting black folks. It was about systems of Europeans and their Christianity and their religions. Well,
Professor Smalls tell a different story.
But they were, in Dr. Jeffrey's generation, it was an onslaught against Europeans, well-financed Europeans. This stuff that's happening between black folks is really irrelevant because we don't have power. And our infighting is preventing us from having power. The thing was, they thought that they financed Dr. Jeffries. They gave him $1 million European education. And they thought that that was enough for him to turn against us over his $1 billion African education. And they felt they was creating a Dr. Jeffries. When he said they gave him the grants, they was creating not a Dr. Leonard Jeffries Jr., who's going to fight for the African world, not a Sheka Auntie Diop, not a Diafalo Benga. They was trying to create Henry Louis Gates, Cornel West, Dr. Anthea Pius, right? And it did not work. So this is the counter, this is the thesis, and they are the antithesis
right.
to that. Now, so Dr. Jeffries, yeah.
Now, with all due respect with you, my brother Reggie, yeah. I'm quite sure there were Negroes at the time of Dr. J as well. Because, look, Malcolm, he had to set some Negroes straight. Baldwin, you know, he went up against Malcolm right there on the thing. So what I'm saying is it had to be Negroes in their generation coming up saying, no, we are this and we are Hebrews and we are Muslims. We are not African because we went through so many years of slavery, the conditioning. So don't think everything with peaches and cream with Dr. Ben and Professor J, because he tells a different story. Professor James Smalls, you know, he talk about how some of them also had to have discussions amongst Hebrew Israelites and stuff like that. So I'm Jeffries saying Dr. Jeffries. I want to hear that's what I'm doing. Hold on, my brother. That's why I'm asking Dr. J. You can't speak for Dr. J. When I ask him, have you went up against any of the people that we are going up against today to keep it on the foundation of it started in Kemet, it started with Africa. We are African people. So when you was coming up, in the back rooms, have y'all been squaring off with, you know, different ideologies as well?
Can I say this one thing? Because I know so much of Dr. Jeffries' history, but I don't know it all, Dr. Jeffries met Haile Selassie.
Hold on, Reggie.
The dynamics? See, this is when it's very, very early. Reggie. I'm going to give it to you, Dr. But you understand what I'm saying, Dr. J, right?
Dr. J is real as it comes, brother. Right.
Ahead, but brother Reggie's trying to bring some clarity to the issue, right. So you have to give him his respect, and so I'm going to give him respect. He's Dr. Reggie Mabry, in my estimation, and what he's trying to say is most people, they may come at me with the Rastafarian ideology or feelings, but they don't know that not only did my wife and I meet the Emperor Haile Selassie one time. We met him 3 or 4 times. And so that, and right now, I'm seeing in the throne room of Jubilee Palace in 19, 73, because we spent a month in Ethiopia in December 73, and we spent another month in January 74. In 1973, the emperor received a couple of hundred scholars from around the world, all sizes, shapes, all colors, all nations. But the most dynamic incident I can remember of the emperor meeting these scholars was when Dr. John Henry Clark approached him, and two brothers of light met each other. I can still see and feel the relationship of these giants, one who carried the banner of Ethiopia and who raised it to the world in terms of the before the United Nations, you had the League of Nations, and in the 1930s, 36 or so, Haile Selassie came to the world to plead for support for Ethiopia. They were being attacked again by the Italians. They had defeated the Italians in the 1890s, and now here they come again in the 1930s with the rise of this new fascism that was in Spain with Franco, that was in Italy with Mussolini, and that became manifestation as Nazism under Hitler. So Haile Selassie has a special place in our world. But in the 60s, after the World War II was over, Haile Selassie allowed Ethiopia to be used as the center for the new African unity and Pan-Africanism. And we had a chance to go in 65, my wife and I. We were there in 70. We met the emperor at that time. We met him again in 73 and 74. So we take away the ideological fervor that people have, and we deal with the reality. And one of our brothers who clarified most of this, and he's somebody that anything that he's written, get a hold of. You don't hear many people talking about him because he's younger than me. He just had his 70th birthday. I'll be having my 79th. But he's powerful. And he deals with the mind. He deals with psychology. I'm talking about Dr. Wade Nobles. And if you do not know Dr. Wade Nobles, you're not in the struggle in a serious way.
I agree.
You're not fortifying yourself with what you need. His most recent contribution to intellectual warfare is that African people everywhere, black people everywhere, suffer greatly from a shattered consciousness and a fractured identity. Let me repeat it. Black people everywhere suffer greatly from a shattered consciousness and a fractured identity. Our minds have been tampered with. And if your minds are tampered with, whoever controls your mind controls your behind. And so we need to begin to appreciate and understand what this brother's saying. And he's put it in action. He's published. He has an institute of research in California. He's had it since the 80s when I first met him. He set up an advanced institute for the study of the black family life. And so now he's making the transition of passing it on to others.
Out of respect for Brother Sarnetta, because he asked a question and I did deflect the question. Was your, in your generation, was the attacks with you fighting people's identities versus Christian, versus Islam, versus Hebrew, as far as black folks, or was your fight with other people?
Both. Say both, because Dr. Khalid, don't forget, Khalid Muhammad fight was with both. Malcolm X fight was with both. Martin Luther King fight was with both.
Dr. Jeffrey is a little older.
He didn't So Khalid didn't just fight the white man. There were Negro adversaries as well. Malcolm X didn't just fight the white man. There were Negro adversaries. So what I'm saying is, just like you are, no, Dr. Jacob got him.
So they can hear you.
So we got Negro adversaries all over the place, brother. That's all I'm saying. Go ahead, Dr. J.
Okay. But here's my contribution to this whole process. None of this intellectual enlightenment, intellectual challenge, intellectual warfare means anything. None of it means a thing if it's not hooked to systems analysis. Systems analysis will allow you to go deep in terms of what you're dealing with. Systems analysis will allow you to see if it's going to be meaningful. You need a systems capability to carry it out. Systems analysis will let you know that once you have an analysis and once you have the system capabilities, then you can truly put in place what we refer to as systems development. None of this discussion and conflicts with each other is going anywhere until it is a part of an agenda of systems development. And that's the approach that those of us who've gotten into this over the last 50, 60 years have taken. Before that time, it was individuals connected with a few others that might have been in conflict. A school coming out of Howard that believed in affirming Negro achievement as opposed to relating it to the African heritage. Negroes who wanted to make sure that the important thing for them was integration into the white society. Maintaining your Negro integrity, but integrating into the white society. And so
the talented tent type
that was part of what we can refer to as the talented tent. Thank you, Dr. Rich. And so we really need to appreciate that we've come to another level. The personal conflicts that one has in terms of their ideology, if it doesn't relate to system capability and systems analysis and systems development, it's not going to take us anywhere. So there was a conflict, for example, between Du Bois and other scholars, and Brother Smalls is familiar with this, and that's why he probably mentioned it. You had an aggressive group of scholars that opposed Du Bois, and but they didn't go into a negative, I'm going to cut your head off conflict. They allowed it to remain at the intellectual level because they knew the importance of systems. And so that's what we're missing. There were African peoples at Howard who said that the Negro with an N is the important thing. We need to emphasize how important the American Negro is. Let's not worry about Africa. Now, this is interesting. And that was a dialogue that went on with Dr. E. Franklin Frazier, who wrote a fantastic book, Black Bourgeoisie, in the 30s and 40s. That was his thing. Of all the people to bring the African to him was a white Jewish scholar who said there are African retentions in the African population in the New World. So he wrote a book called The Myth of the Negro Past. And he helped African scholars look at the African retentions in the populations in the Caribbean and the populations in Black America and the populations in Brazil and South America. And so a growing consciousness of the African retentions became a school of knowledge. The head of that school became Leo Hansberry, Professor Leo Hansberry, who was at Harvard, who graduated with a degree from Harvard or University of Chicago, but who was at Howard, where he developed the Hansberry School. And Hansberry School helped a young scholar like Dr. Chancellor Williams do his monumental work, travel to Africa, and then come at it at a higher level than previously was allowed in the 20s and 30s. So the important thing is to not to nail somebody at a historical period or lay on him or her a heavy ideology that does not allow him to see the larger systems. We have to bust that. And for example, part of the school of Leo Hansberry was a brother who we don't associate with intellectual development in a real way. That's Dr. Ralph Bunche, because he decided his mission was going to be contributed to the development of the United Nations. But when W.E.B. Du Bois, who was based in Philadelphia, and the Howard School, when they were trying to deal with Africanness, and the village of Harlem, became the site of people dealing with these things. A young man, one of our greatest, Dr. Clark has revered him and has put him in his great work, Notes for the African World Revolution, Africans at the Crossroads. And on the he talks about the unfinished revolutions of Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, of the Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey, of Patrice Lumumba, and of Malcolm X. And so I'm saying, brothers and sisters, don't freeze yourself at a particular point or get enmeshed in an ideology that you can't get out of it, you can't see the larger picture. Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, who became the leader of the Pan-African movement and the linking of Africans around the world, left Ghana being taught by one of the great Africans, Dr. Agre. They referred to him as Agre of Africa. He actually came to the United States and taught at Livingstone College in the Carolinas and married an African-American woman. So he brought an African consciousness that he had attempted to put into young potential leaders like Kwame Nkrumah. But Kwame Nkrumah didn't come to be a head of state. He didn't come to lead a African revolution. He came to be a preacher. And he came to Lincoln University. And at Lincoln University, he was imbued with the ideas of what a preacher should be all about. But other ideas was in the air. And so a friend of his, Philip Philpott, actually drove him from Lincoln University, which is near Philadelphia, to Philadelphia. And there the work of W.E.B. Du Bois was going through transformation. From his early work, the Ph.D. in 1895 at Harvard, which dealt with the slave trade, to his later work, which was on sociology, 1900 or thereabout, the Philadelphia Negro dealing with sociology, to his later work, 10 or 15 years later, in terms of Pan-Africanism, to W.E.B. Du Bois's later work in the 30s, in which he revisited Reconstruction, because his Ph.D. was on the suppression of the African slave trade. But he now had a new consciousness. He was more into socialism. He had an understanding of Marxism and communism. So he revisited the Reconstruction period, and he came up with a great revival of that period called Black Reconstruction. And then a few years later, when the world was in turmoil and there was a World War I, he came up with another work, Africa and the World. So you can't freeze Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois at one period and say, this is the man, or any of our great leaders, or so Malcolm.
Sarnetta is probably, because, you know, we are debating ideas. That's right. What we're doing these days. And people are seeing that it's kind of disruptive because we're challenging old ideas for another generation. So in this thing, you do have a debate between Du Bois and Booker T. You have a debate between Du Bois and Marcus Garvey.
Right.
You have these, and then...
And Du Bois and the more radical African scholars of his age. So this going on is a part of what we can call intellectual growth and development. But you have to be willing to accept ideas and expand the understanding. And Nkrumah, ideas is what Dr. Wade Nobles is dealing with, and his latest work is about the Haitian Revolution, and it's called The Island of Mimes, M-E-M-E-S. And what he means is ideas, ideas that affect your development, ideas that cause you to become seriously involved in something. And so he deals with the Haitian Revolution in the 1700s through the early 1800s in terms of the mind of the leader. So And Nkrumah becomes a Pan-Africanist when he moved around the African world in a triangle of light that I referred to, going to Philadelphia, where the work of W.E.B. Du Bois, he was able to meet with people who was carrying on the work of W.E.B. Du Bois. Then Philpott would take him at another period down to Howard University, and he would meet those who were part of the Hansberry School. The office of Ralph Bunche was right next to Hansberry. So Nkrumah would get greater ideas and understanding from these brothers who were spending their life raising up African consciousness. And then that's the foundation, Philadelphia and Washington. But then he'd come to the Big Apple, to the village of Harlem. And that would be thesis, antithesis, synthesis, or concepts, analysis, and processes. And so it was in Harlem that he met Dr. John Henry Clark and those who had put together the Harlem History Club. It was in Harlem that he met those who, like Dr. Ben, who were pursuing the Nile Valley.
Dr. J, they're going to have to sit in your class to hear the whole conversation. But see, Sarnetta, he this generation has a...
Let me ask it. Don't
yeah, I'm going to give it to Sarnetta, right? So Dr. J, get ready for this, right? Because...
All right, my brother, my elder, Dr. Jeffries. And I'm going to blame, and I'm going to blame my brother, Dr. Reggie, for this, because Dr. Reggie has been the closest to you so far amongst us. Relax. Dr. Reggie has been the closest to you from amongst us, like such as Brother Polite, Minister Inky, the Armor Rock Squad, the young people that's out there today. I blame Dr. Reggie. Because Dr. Reggie have not been keeping you abreast of what's going on today. Hold on, brother. Just relax. Don't start shaking in your boots. I ain't even asked the question yet. There's a group out there, Dr. Jeffries, that you may not know right now who calls themselves the Moors. This group of the Moors say slavery never happened. So now you got these young scholars like the Armin Ra Squad, Brother Polite. They are defending that, saying, how you going to tell and teach our babies out there today that slavery never happened? This is why this is so important, because if we don't correct the history 10 years down the road, like they are trying to say Malcolm X was a homosexual today. I know you know that. There's a group of whites now saying that Malcolm is a homo. So if you don't have these young brothers coming up now, hold up. Right. But if you don't have, if we can't correct them and say, well, nah, man, we got to uphold our history. Then there's also another group out there who calls themselves the Hebrew Israelites, who are now saying, fuck Africa. It's not about Africa. We are Hebrew Israelites. It's about the Most High, Yahshua. You know, bro, I'm not trying to start nothing, but what I'm saying is we got to correct this history. You see?
I've been in a cocoon.
There you go. That's what I'm saying.
Walked up and down 125th Street. I've even crossed 125th Street where Brother Sekou, trying to get to Brother Sekou, and had people follow me across the street threatening me. You're wrong. Dr. Ben is wrong. Dr. Clark is wrong.
Now that's what I'm
and
talking.
I have to tell him to. I have to tell him to step back a little because I got martial arts training, so don't get too bodacious. But I can understand the dynamic that's going on. The Africans have a parable. There were five blind men. Let's make it six. And they was moving through the world together, and they ran upon this largest of mammals called the elephant. And one grabbed the hole of his tail, and he said, hey, this is something here. It's like a snake, and I'm just holding it, and it's ready to wiggle out of my hands. And then one of the other brothers who was further up on the animal had one of the back legs. He said, well, damn, what I got is a tree trunk, and I can't even put my arms around it. And then further up, one of the other brothers had something that was the trunk. And he said, well, hold it. And then one of the other brothers had gotten something that was so hard, he said, this feels like money. And it was the tusk. All of them had a piece of the knowledge and understanding, but none of them had the systems understanding to link it together. And so they would be at a loss to see what this phenomena is that they can use and they need. But if they got a piece of it and you're going to beat your brother up because he got another piece of it and you can only see your piece. So we've got to approach this. Yes, we need the intellectual warfare. Yes, we need to deal with each other in terms of these ideas. But it should be a labor of love, not a destructive process. And we need to see that we are struggling with each other in order to put together the greatest responsibility we have, which is building our power for the world systems that are coming at us. And if you don't understand, the Chinese may have their fights with each other, whether it's the Mandarin Chinese or the Cantonese Chinese or the Hong Kong Chinese or the Beijing Chinese or the Confucian Chinese. The Chinese are going to unify around the understanding that it is China's time. And they're going to put the three components of power together, systems power together, economics. If you use the triangle, which I also use to teach, economics is the first principle. It's the foundation principle. It is your creative, productive capability. And that economics, however, can't go nowhere if it's not managed right. And so management is your political capability. Politics is how you manage your life, how you administrate it. Your world. And the most important thing to administer is your survival, which is your economics and your politics. So life is founded upon these twin principles of economics and politics. However, your economics can't do what it needs to do and be what it needs to be, or your politics can't serve you well unless culture is in the picture. And culture is the mind. And it is the mind that tells you what type of economics to develop, and the mind to tell you who to do your politics with. And so you need the three working together to take on the challenge of serious intellectual warfare and global struggle and galactic struggle. And so have your bouts, but if you want, where you are is playing ping pong in the basement. You've got to take that knowledge that you're coming into and that concept of struggle that you are developing, and understand that the big boys are out there and they're not going to go away. They have to be challenged. And so there are global communities coming together. The Arab world is coming together with their understanding of what they want in reference to the Arab world and Islam. The Chinese community is coming together and they're linking their economics, politics, and their culture together. They're not fighting over Mao Zedong's legacy or the legacy of Confucius. They're synthesizing it. The Indian community is doing the same thing. They're not fighting whether it's the modern scientists coming out of India or it's the Hindu tradition that's a part of Indian culture, or it's the political structure that they developed that they might have inherited from Gandhi and the post-Gandhi era. They are hooking up their economics, politics, and culture for the global battle. African peoples have to work out their relationship with each other, and these ideologies that have put us in a closet, come out of the closet, leave your ideologies in there, and deal with the real world, which is to get control of the economics of the world, control of politics of the world, and develop the culture of the world. And we have a right to do it because we are the first people who understood that you needed culture, you needed economics, you needed politics, you needed systems in order to grow and develop.
I agree with everything you said, Dr. J. Beautiful. But what I'm saying is... All right, no buts. What I'm saying, my elder... is that in 2015 going into 16, we are the only people that still don't know who we are. When we talk about coming together in unity, we have to first clean house. We never had that discussion on who we are as a people moving forward. We never sat in that room and didn't leave out. I'm talking about you get the Moors, the Hebrews, the Muslims, the Christians, the Black Pan-Africanists. We never had this real sit down and not leave out of that room until we first come together on who we are as a people moving forward. The reason I'm saying that is because we are supposed to be taking a historical picture December the 12th. Whereas the Hebrews, the Muslims, the Africans, the us, the revolutionaries, we supposed to be going to sit. You've seen that great famous picture with Prophet Noble Drew Ali in front of a brownstone. Well, we supposed to be up doing that. Don't you know that I'm in a battle right now with some of the Moorish brothers saying they don't want to be in the picture because who's going to control the picture? We don't want to have black power on the picture. Or we don't want to be in the picture and, you know, it's people there that's saying black. You see the condition of the mind of our people is in. Instead of them saying, well, we're going to all come together to show this unity force, they worrying about, is it going to be red, black, and green in the picture? Like, I mean, come on, man. You know, it's crazy when we got to deal with that type of mind today.
So on the 12th, I guess the 12th is Saturday.
The 13th.
Oh, it's the 13th. Oh, so your activity is on Sunday. Okay, right. Because I don't want it to conflict with mine. I'll be having a big activity at Dr. John Henry Clark House if it's available on the 12th.
And so we're going to a museum tour on the 12th.
Okay. But if you go to a museum tour and our brother, Professor Enfidishi, is not there leading you, you're going to be in trouble. Or my wife, Queen Mother Rosin, is not leading you. But if you don't have either one of them, then Brother Reggie can handle
Thank
it.
You so much.
But what we're saying is, how do we find an operational unity to allow us to empower ourselves to deal with the great world struggles that are going on? And you're correct. People get a hold of a bit of the knowledge and they want to transform the world with it. But that's not going to work. They have what I call a paralysis of analysis. And so I can appreciate it and I sympathize. Because some of us growing up, we got a hold of, our families wanted to find a place in America, so we got a hold of Negroness. And we made it into something special. We put an end on it, a capital N. And then we wanted to be Negro achievers. And we could achieve even beyond white folks, so we could find a niche in their society. And so many of us had fights and conflicts in that, because some people say, wait a minute, we need more than that. And we need to not just be satisfied with the American system and all those contradictions that are in the American system. We need to struggle against it and come up with something better. So our people have waged an enormous struggle to come up with a higher objective, which is the unity of African peoples on the planet, unification of the African continent, Africans in the diaspora. But you're more than Jamaican. That's the accident of where one of the slave ships stopped. You're more than Brazil, which is a continent. You are African. That defines you writ large. Now, people say, well, there was no Africa. Well, there was a continent where black people emerged. Well, nobody called themselves African. That may well be because they didn't look continentally. But wherever they are, they named themselves as special peoples of that area because they knew they had inherited a blessed continent. They knew they had been hooked up with a mission that was beyond themselves. They knew that there were ancestral worlds that they had to pay homage to. They knew that it was a contemporary world that extended way beyond them. They knew that they had a responsibility to the yet to be born. So that's the framework for developing our traditions of being the chosen people of God. Not a text, not an interpretation, or not hyperbole, or not just an incident such as the dividing of the waters and the Pharaoh's army being. So you can get hung up on that paralysis of analysis and you will not have the strength and the power to pull together our global community and make your contribution.
So we began this lecture with you being in Europe and meeting people and they're saying, je suis français.
Je suis French. I'm French.
I am French. We have
proud.
We have now this dilemma, which Sarnetta eloquently posed, is that we have people saying, I'm not black, I'm Hebrew. I'm not black, I'm Moor. I'm not black.
Or African.
Or I'm just using black and Africa to mean the same thing. Mm-hmm. I'm Islam, right? That is our new je suis français. And these people, you can't, when they hear you, first of all, they're in the chat rooms and other places. They despise every time you say the word African.
African!
And every time you say the word black, right? They despise it. They are trying to rewrite history to say that we, when I say to you, for example,
all the work that you have done, Dr. Ben and Dr. Clark, all of that work, they
try to. Dr. Jeffy, you are not an African American. You are not a black American. You are
a Hebrew.
Dr. Jeffries, you are not a black American. You are not an African American. Forget that whole experience.
Egypt is a dead science. You're not.
You are a Moor, right? Dr. Jeffries, you have no relationship to Nile Valley. I don't care about Shekinah Diop, Diafalo Banga, right?
That's what we're up against.
Our generation is, and so that's why we stand with you and we stand with the information. And it's another generational talk, because when Dr. Ben died, Dr. Jeffries, they didn't see the impact we felt. You know what they said? Hooray!
Well, now, hold on, real quick. And let me show you why
this is important. Because they are teaching their babies this. There's a group of Hebrews that teach their babies this. There's a group of the Moors that teach their babies this. So when we are long gone, our baby's going to be doing the same thing we're doing today, Reggie. It's going up against their babies. Now, we are this and we are that. That's why I'm saying, hold on. That's why I'm saying this is important. See, we can't sweep it under the rug and think, that's just some little stuff. No, this is big, because the babies are going to be fighting the same babies again when we're long gone. Because we are fighting age-old enemies today. The same people Harriet Tubman, Nat Turner was fighting, we are fighting age-old enemies today. We're still going up against the same people.
I would pose it differently. I would pose it in a sense. I would pose it as Dr. Jeffrey, African scholar, black American scholar, right, in this country. You have some peers. There is Dr. Malefi Kitesante. There's Diafalo Benga.
There's many.
But you are one of the – what I would like you to do is I understand what Sonnet is saying. See, there's our petty issues, and then there's the larger pictures,
right? There you go.
Right? Go into the making of Dr. Leonard Jeffries. Why are we an African people, Dr. Jeffries? Give us a definitive case as to why we are an African people, and we need to look that direction instead of looking at any of the other directions, for example, religion, right? Looking at our petty differences, our skin colors, our class. Dr. Jeffries, why did you leave law school, decided not to be a politician, right? Why did you look to the continent of Africa for the salvation of African people? Why did you do that, Dr. Jeffries? Or did you waste your time?
Oh, I certainly haven't wasted my time. I've been blessed. And it's been a great, not a great and mighty walk, as our brother Wesley Snipes who did a fantastic portrayal of Dr. Clark, and he talked about his great and mighty walk. We have been a part of an explosion of information, and it's a revolutionary process that has actually taken place. And so if we do not develop the dynamic to understand it and appreciate it, we're going to remain the doormats of the human family. I see the victory. The victory is at hand. The truth of who and what we are. No matter what you call us, the first people on the planet were our roots, our heritage, our ancestors. The people who took human development to its highest level were our ancestors. Other people came in as Johnny Come Latelys. And as Dr. Ben often said, they deified a culture. Understand that concept, because when I teach, I try to teach, you go to the top of the pyramid, to the keystone, to the pyramidum at the top of the pyramid, and you deal with concepts, analyses, processes, and link them together in terms of systems. So the concept that people who lack knowledge, who come out of the darkness into the light, have a tendency to feel that this is a God-given blessing, And this is what has to be imposed upon everybody. And so they have what I call the paralysis of analysis, and they're willing to die for this. So we have to understand that's a human process. Those who came from the darkness of the caves of Europe and came into the light of the river valleys developed their cultural dynamic, which unfortunately did not have the balance and the harmony, did not come out of gardens of Eden. They came out of ferocious ecologies.
Ice.
That the ice concept of what I call individualism, ice for I, competitism, and exploitationism. And so that culture of barbarism in the northern cradle has been imposed upon the modern world. But that's not the deep culture that allows us to function on the planet and to function in the universe and the cosmos. Our people found the key to functioning, that you are part of a greater world that's way beyond you personally, that goes back to the beginning of time, and that is tied into the future. And where do we find it? One of our great scholars, and this is the victory, coming from the continent itself, Dr. Shekhanta Jupp, one of his first works that was synthesized by Dr. Mercer Cook of Howard University was African Origin of Civilization, Myth and Reality. And so that was produced by him in the 50s and 60s. However, it was synthesized by Mercer Cook in the 70s. But by 81, this brother had taken this great work that he and others were involved in, and he produced the victory. This is the victory. If there's anybody, well, I'll hold on. You hold on to that one.
Yes.
I'll hold on to this one. That's paralysis of analysis.
Okay.
Whatever you call people of color, that's what they can be called. We're talking about people of color. We're not talking about some white man naming us. Africans understood what it's all about.
He said that we didn't have a continental name. This experience came, the naming came when the Europe was coming out of its situation. And they encountered Africa.
Right.
And they named continent of Africa over out of a group of African people as a conquest, as a
right.
moniker.
Just
but
as
we're not dealing with
right.
that.
Just as earlier the Greeks referred to them as Ethiopians. In other words, people of burnt face. So Europeans have helped us define ourselves for ourselves. We need to go back to the African definition of self. For example, in the Nile Valley, you'll have people talking about Kem. And Kem refers to the black land and black people and black understanding of the universe. Out of the black hole comes the light. So we have to go back to the root. We get stuck when we take these little instances. They create the paralysis of analysis. Reggie is holding in his hands the victory. That's the book that Shekhanta Diop was able to give to the world. But that's the one that was published in 91. The one that I have in my hand is the original. This is the one that was published in 10 years before, 81. This is the original copy that I took to Switzerland to try to translate.
And what was the name in French?
And the name in French is Civilisation ou Barbarie. Civilization or barbarism. And what Shekhanta Diop is saying is those who did not come out of the sun and the cultures that were produced in the river valleys and the lakes have a culture of barbarism that was forged in the cradle, the northern cradle of the ice. And so this dynamic of the northern cradle and the southern cradle is a part of the arguments that you have. Many people who have come out of their particular circumstances and came into the light had to devise a means of saying that this is us, this is a part of our culture. So they had to dismiss the people who were the originals. And most people need to know that this is historic. This is the first time out of my house. This is the work I took to Switzerland in 1983 when Dr. Clark says, this work has to be published in English. We can't wait 20 years. So in my 50 years of teaching, the only time I took sabbatical leave was in 1983, developing the largest black studies program in the world working with African scholars, reclaiming our heritage, I took a year off to go back to Switzerland, the World Council of Churches, and to try to tackle this. As bright and as brilliant as I may be, I was in deep water and sinking, because the first 100 pages is not addressed to me and you. It's addressed to the scholarship of the universe. It's addressed to scholars. I had to get 30 or 40 books to get into. I had to do a whole relearning to deal with the first 100 pages. And I had just gotten to the first 100 pages, which is the approach, a paleontological approach, meaning we have to go back millions of years to deal with human development. And that human development, by Glover's Law, G-L-O-G-E-R, states that mammals in the sun develop melanin to resist the ultraviolet rays of the sun. So if humans have existed on the planet thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of years, they have had to be melanized and black or brown or whatever you want to call them. And so the origin goes beyond 6,000 years. The origin goes to the deep foundation of the human family.
We are supposed to dismiss scientific evidence of the march of humanity through its different phases for a story, an allegorical story, or are we supposed to take the story, right, and collapse it into the scientific
and history? See where it fits in, right, the scientific, in the truth
but
of the human family?
Make the allegory the scientific statement.
So that's the responsibility of the struggle that you and others are engaged in is to show this knowledge, but show it with respect, show it with understanding, because people have been bamboozled. The truth is now out. You tap into that truth and you improve your development and your people's development. You tap away from it, and we will be caught in a stagnation of ideas and misunderstandings.
Internal wars.
And internal wars that will not allow us to do what we have to do. When you put that pyramid together, that triangle together, at one polarity you have what is called the thesis. That's the foundation. At the other polarity you have the opposite of that, because there's a law of opposites in the universe. And so the thesis for the human family is people who are called African, no matter what you want to call them. The antithesis is the emergence out of the African gene pool of another section of the human family that is indebted to Africans for their gene. However, their cultural experience has created another consciousness, another mindset. And so what Dr. Diop points out in the second part of his work is that the first 100 pages goes back millions of years. And every time they find something deep in Africa, it takes us back even more millions. After that first 100 pages, he deals with the next 100 pages, which is the cradles of civilization. And he talks about the duality of the northern cradle, which comes out of the southern cradle. Africans marched out of Africa and peopled the rest of the globe, including the islands of the Pacific. And however, when the great Wormian Ice Age kicked in 100,000 years ago, the Earth's axis was turned and a great ice age set in, and we are still in that ice age. And it's been for the last 100,000 years. Those who have had the benefit of the sun and the lakes and the rivers and the plains have produced high culture and civilization. Those who have had to survive in a cave as large as this apartment, you might have a clan of 20 people. And can you imagine in the survival culture of that nature, trying to get their economics and their politics and their culture together, they produced a brilliant cave culture. But that's all it was. And that cave culture was linked up to other caves. But you didn't have a relationship of a polite relationship with that other cave, because the other cave was in their caves hoping that in the back of the cave was not the mother bear and hibernating, and that she didn't wake up. Then you'd have to fight internally in your cave to kill mother bear. And if the mother bear was not in your cave but was in somebody else's cave and she ran mother bear ran them out of the cave, they'd have to come out in the snow looking for a safe haven. And that safe haven would be the next cave. And so they didn't come into the cave and knock on the cave door and say, we are here and we need shelter. They came in armed to fight for their survival. And so this whole question of cave survival and aggressiveness and putting a premium on the warrior. So when the babies came in the cave culture, if it was a girl, all they need is one girl. She can produce many children. If it was another girl, she's eliminated. If it was another girl, she's eliminated. So they put a premium on the male child. That is not the culture of the plains and the lakes. Every life is sacred. Every life, male and female, is sacred. Dr. Ben was making a point in the little clip that we saw about this whole factor of the centrality of the female and the inheritance passing to the female. Most African cultures are matrilineal, and then they have a patriarchal component to that. So these are the deep concepts that Dr. Diop deals with in the second 100 pages. So you got the northern cradle, the southern cradle, the cradle of the sun, which is civilization, and the cradle of the ice, which is barbarism. And then he has the third 100 component is African contribution to science and technology and philosophy. And he nails it there. He has a small fourth chapter, which is culture. The key to all of this being transmitted and understood is culture. So we can't just say we're cultural nationalists. We used to have that fight. And then some were revolutionary nationalists. And some were just stayed out socialists. But we've gone through this.
Are we the seed of the father or is it the mother?
Science and Africans.
A lot of people say, well, you know, you are what your father is, Africans, not your mother.
Africans understood. They didn't have the deep modern science, but they understood that the human was created with the duality of the male and the female component to life. They understood that it was the combination of the male's contribution coming from his semen and the woman's contribution coming from the egg within her. They even linked this understanding, which you couldn't get in a cave because you may not even see the sun or the star. You on the plains of Africa and along the riverbanks, you could see that at a certain point, there's a flow coming in from inner Africa, and that creates an overflow of the Nile. And because you understand that you're beyond your human self, you began to study the universe. And as you learn that life is change, transformation, rebirth, change, transformation, regeneration, change, transformation, or degeneration, you develop philosophical and concepts that we may have to study the stars, because when it appears every season, the Nile overflows and the other rivers overflow, and there's a certain set of stars in the sky. And then after 4 months of fertilizing the areas around the banks of the Nile, that certain set of stars is here. And they call it the inundation. And then you can begin to see the Nile retreat. And so with the black land fertilized from inner Africa, you can plant your crop. And then after another period of time, that crop produces a harvest. And you might even get two crops. So they began to relate the human existence on planet Earth to the cosmos. And then they move into an understanding that that cosmos that you're related to is related to the speciality of the human. Because as you relate to your female component, your wife, and your sperm is passed into her with the ejaculation, that process takes place when a certain set of stars are here. And then after a period of time, there is growth in your woman and a certain set of stars are there. And then after a period of time, the harvest takes place. So you begin to relate the divine order of the universe to the divine order of the human life and all life related to it. That's the deep philosophical concept that produces all of these later religious traditions.
The war against Africans, Dr. Jeffries.
And so there
when did this change? When other peoples wanted to deify themselves, right? Where they were resource poor, people poor. They wanted what Africa had. What is the war against Africa?
Talks about people coming into our world, and we, believing in the divine order of the universe, usually welcome them. Because they look like humans. We relate to the elephants, the lions, and all other life. We relate to plant life, and we see its relationship to the divine order. And so we inevitably accept new folks coming into our world without understanding what was the mind that developed it. What was the predator mind that developed these outsiders? So they come in to dominate. They come in to have that value system I call the 3 Ds, domination, destruction, and death, as opposed to the African value system, which is the 3 Cs, communal, cooperative, and collective. Communal, living together. Cooperative, working together. Collective, sharing together. And that value system is deep in the African traditions even today. It helped to build the great cultures and civilizations. It helped to maintain the village. Africans believe in not just the individual as representing the human, they believe in the human extended out to others that are the living.
The war
extended
against
to the ancestors, extended to the yet to be born, and so there
this
have
war,
been
this war that came upon your own life. This war
the,
that
we
that,
can take my own personal circumstances that occurred in the 60s and the 70s and reached its height in the 80s, end of the 80s and 90s, that we have accepted the gift that Dr. Ben gave, which is the gift that keeps on giving, that Dr. Clark gave, a look at the world from an African perspective, and the other scholars gave, that war that has been going on for thousands of years reached its height in the 90s. And it's a war against Africans at every level, a war against Africans economically, a war against Africans politically, a war against Africans culturally. So that means it's a war against culture and education, scientific knowledge.
So that our young people don't know about this war. They don't know the facts. They just think that they can read a Bible, they could read a Quran, they could read a holy book and get all the information from the world, right? From that book, mm-hmm. without the details of the war.
Yeah.
We have you here in the House of Consciousness to begin. Listen, everybody, at the end of the day, Dr. Jeffries is not going to do this all today. It's impossible. This is an introductory to something, to Dr. Jeffries coming back to the House of Consciousness. In the meantime, make sure you go to www.gofundme.com/Leonard Jeffries and donate to this elder.
And give us some help. It's needed. But what the brothers, Dr. Reggie and the others that are, Sarnetta and the others that are into the new consciousness, they are on the front lines of dealing with the war at whatever level it takes place. I've been on the front line. I've had the greatest attack in the history of the world ever waged against a scholar thrown at me. And I'm still here today to say the victory is in Black power. The victory is in this knowledge of who and what we are and that we are an African people.
What was that fight about, Dr. Jeffries?
And, well, it's a continuation of a fight that has gone on. I came into it to be targeted and to be destroyed so that the fear factor will abound in our world. But they didn't realize that what I was standing on was not me. I'm standing on the tradition of African knowledge and understanding. I'm standing on deep African cultural traditions that come out of the Black experience of survival, that come out of even the early Black churches.
But why is that so dangerous?
Institutions.
Why is that so transformative I come out of
giving Black people the European education, but letting the European education be put in the context of the multi-billion dollar African education so that the European education would not create a Black European. It would create an African with a consciousness of the European experience and able to use it. So what we're saying is that we are at war. We did not start the war. It was brought to us. And we have to engage in it. But the victory is the knowledge. The victory is the understanding. And people who have been involved in the war is Dr. John Henry Clark, for example. This is a work that he produced. Christopher Columbus and the African Holocaust. And so it is subtitled Slavery and the Rise of European Capitalism. Dr. John Henry Clark, with an E at the end, with a foreword by Leonard Jeffries, his partner, and afterward, a preface by Professor Edward Scobie, who was my partner at City College when we developed the largest and most comprehensive Black Studies department in the world. And then Dr. John Henry Clark let us know that others who went before have been dealing with the warfare. And so Patrice Lumumba, well, let's go before Patrice Lumumba, Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey, that's a picture of Edward Scobie, who came from a little island in the Caribbean, Dominica, but who developed, as he moved to Europe and traveled around the African world, a great African consciousness. He was one of our great Pan-African leaders. But what Dr. John Henry Clark has given us is a look at these great African leaders. And of course, Marcus Garvey is one. And you cannot deal with Marcus Garvey without relating to Booker T. Washington, because he was inspired by Booker T. to come to America to put in place institutions of self-reliance and self-development, like Tuskegee Institute was. And then you can't dismiss a brother like W.E.B. Du Bois, who says, you need to have a foundation for your families and your people, but you need a leadership group that's cultivated to help your people move along the way. And so the talented tenth is not a negative, but the talented tenth has to be trained to serve the masses of people. The masses of people are not a negative, because if you don't have the people that produce, the people that can continue the work, you're not going anywhere. So that you need a systems analysis to see where all of this is.
Why is this work so dangerous? What does it do for African people? Billions of African people are around the globe, right? Does it unify us? Does the truth unify us? Why is it so dangerous to the European and to the Arab and to those people, the subclasses of Arabs? Why, Dr. Jeffries?
Well, it's dangerous because knowledge is power. And African knowledge is African power. Deep African knowledge is the African victory. And we have been able to tap into that. And so as I look at the history, I like to give some frameworks of analysis. And so one of the important things that I contribute, and I started making this contribution way back in 1969. This is the course outline, the first Black course taught in political science at City College. Politics of Race in the United States, the spring of 1969. And so I taught the first course at Black Studies at City College, and then the young people, inspired by Kwame Ture, inspired by the death of Martin Luther King, who had turned into a revolutionary when he said, take control of your world, stand up, take control of the economics. Raised the question of poverty, raised the question of reparations. So Malcolm had reached a revolutionary point where he was seeing the world writ large and forming the OAAU to complement the OAU, which was formed in 1963, and Malcolm formed his comparable organization in 1964. And at that same time, Martin Luther King was going through change, transformation,
What are some of the books, Dr.
James? When he raised up, just let me put King in the revolutionary change, that he began to see that marching was not enough, that sitting in was not enough, and that we had to challenge the system economically. And so he called for the People's March and was willing to give his life when he said he's going to go up against the economics of the times. And so King's death led to the explosion of Black Studies, because Kwame Ture, Stokely Carmichael before, and Rap Brown and others went around to the students on the campus and said, you're not getting a real education, you're getting a whitewash. Your degrees will not help you in the African struggle and the Black struggle, wherever we are. You need to have knowledge of our people and their struggles. So Black Studies emerged in 68, 69, out of this consciousness after the death of Martin Luther King. And so when I was asked to teach a black course at City College, this was the course. And the course involves several sections. In order for me to get it together, let me throw on my glasses. But the course is a chance to deal with students of this course. Thank you, Brother Reggie, Doctor. Students who wish to take the course for full credit will be required to take a midterm and a final examination and submit a term paper. Details concerning the paper will be given in class. Items selected for weekly readings are on reserve in the college library. Books recommended for purchase. For students who do not have an extensive background in black history, John Hope Franklin, From Slavery to Freedom, published in 1967. For all other students, Voices of Negro Protest in America, developed in 1963 by a person who became a great lawyer, Hayward Burns, and who developed the law program at City College. I recommended that we bring him in from NYU to join us. Another book recommended, published in 1968, Joanne Grant, a black sister who had a revolutionary understanding of things, and she wrote a book called Black Protest, History, Documents, and Analysis. And of course, John Hope Franklin also produced with a Professor Starr, The Negro in the 20th Century. A white scholar, Jewish background, Arnold Rose produced The Negro in America. Albert Blaustein produced Civil Rights and the American Negro. And then some of our own produced work. Kenneth Clark, a professor in psychology, produced Dark Ghetto in 1960.
I'm saying Dr. Stephen Jeffries.
Carmichael and his assistant, who was also a professor at Columbia, they produced Black Power in 1967. And then there are three Negro classics, Booker T. Washington, Up From Slavery, W.E.B. Du Bois, The Souls of Black, and Johnson, The Autobiography of Black. But that was...
Most of us couldn't even pass this class, Dr. Jeffries. This is the problem. What I'm just trying to say is that the work that has happened in black studies, before these people can even decide that they want to debate, what are they debating with, Dr. Jeffries? My point of there is a sweep of history. There are hundreds and hundreds of volumes of well-written black work.
Or white scholars who understood the significance of black history and made their contribution.
Hundreds more.
And so
we
that's the knowledge that has to be tapped into. And you can't spend your time in getting a little bit of the knowledge and going to war with each other. Because the great struggle is down the road. There is going to be a clash of the great movements of human history. The Asians are mobilizing. The Europeans, there was supposed to be a war for 1,000 years between communism and capitalism in Europe. They are now having a relationship with each other. And the folks who are the desert people, many of them Arabs, they now, using oil monies of the 70s, have created a global family, just as the current Asians are using the current situation to produce a global family in India and China. So, and white folks have had a tradition of producing honorary whites. The Japanese were considered honorary whites by the Americans after they defeated the Russians in 1905. And the racist South African apartheid government, which was established in 1948, they made the Japanese honorary whites in South Africa. So there is at hand a struggle that we have to be a part of. I call it the 50-year turning point of history. In order to understand these great historical periods and their impact, this is the period in which Columbus and others moved out of Europe and by accidents bumped into a new possibility and new lands and new worlds and new people.
What are some of the dates? 1482. Let's just go through some of the dates.
1482 to 14 to 15, 36 is what I call the European period, the modern rise of Europe. And it's in that time that the discovery of the new worlds, the institutionalization of the exploitation of black people with slavery, new technology and new instruments of controlling economics, such as capitalism, emerge.
Contracts, and, entering into contracts.
And contracts that produce a controlling system of politics. A new nation state emerged. Out of the feudalism now comes a nation state that's an instrument of managing the economics. And then culturally, you have the institutionalization of white supremacy with the Catholic Church saying that these new Catholic nations, Spain and Portugal, have the right to dominate the world. And they actually had a line from the North Pole to the South Pole in which, with a papal bull, one part of the world was given to Spain and another part was given to Portugal. These historical incidents led to the systems of domination, destruction, and death, which still rule the world today. That's not a part of our history. We've been abused by it. We've been misused by it. We've been in the process of dehumanization by it.
But our
histories prior to that period of time are represented by the great cultures of African people around the world. So this period of history, 1482, the Columbus period, the period where Moorish history and culture is important, allowed the Europeans to move on central stage and dominate it and push everybody else off. And they are still continuing that process. And the big prize, as it has always been, is in Africa. Why? Because if we go back to the African Golden Age, and one of them that is important for all of us is the Golden Age of the New Kingdom. And that's the Golden Age, 1490s to 1450. That's the period in the New Kingdom of the dynasty that was centered around Queen Tiye and her great husband, Amenophis III. He was one of the Amenophis the Great. Their statue in the Cairo Museum is one of the greatest statues in the Cairo Museum, a two-story statue in which she is sitting there with equal power with her husband. She ruled with him for 36 years when they ruled together. When he died, she ruled as Queen Mother Regent for 12 years by herself. And then for 16 years, when her son, the Pharaoh Akhenaten, ruled, she was Queen Mother Regent. She made the arrangements for Nefertiti to come and marry into the royal family. Nefertiti comes out of Africa in Mitanni and was a diplomatic marriage. This woman changed the literature of the world. Their family changed the concept and renewed the concept among the Nile Valley Africans in terms of the oneness of God. They actually attempted to move up the Nile and build a new city of God.
You're talking about Akhenaten.
The Pharaoh Akhenaten and his mother,
Queen Tiye,
and then the younger generation was King Tut. So all that people focus on is the gold mass of King Tut, and not the philosophy, the culture, the science that was developed by our great...
So we have another interruption. So at this period, we're talking about the golden ages of
the African civilizations all over the continent. And we can just take that one period, which everybody knows because you know King Tut. You know Nefertiti, but you don't know it deep enough in order to deal with it. And there's a picture of Sarneta and our great Gil Noble, who had his life changed.
That's right.
Had his life changed.
That's right.
When in 82... Reverend Calvin O'Butts, myself, and Sini Williams, the head of the Black Social Workers, went into ABC and fought that his program be maintained on the TV station. We had picket outside ABC's office. We had children from the Child Development Center, Sons of Africa. We had a medical doctor, a paraplegic in a wheelchair, in his motorized vehicle going around supporting Gil. And from that point on, Gil Noble was left alone until he finally left us many decades later. But he was able to produce some of his great work. And one of the great moments in his history was relating to Dr. Ben over the years. But then when we formed the Association for the Study of Classical African Civilizations after a conference in 84, we decided to institutionalize this study of the Nile in 85 and meet in Chicago, and we incorporated. Then we met in New York so that we could put a foundation under this organization of scholars. 500 of us met in 84, and we decided we would stay together, put our fights, our conflicts aside, put them in the closet, and then come out with a unified African mind, and it has been that way since. 86 at the conference in New York, Brother Reggie was there, and others were there. Reggie had led a group of us to West Africa in 86, which included Dr. Clark, Dr. Clark's son, and my nephew, Dr. Hassan and Jeffries, Small. And Malik Smalls. Reggie was given the responsibility of taking care of our legacy. These youngsters, they were 12 and 13, and put in the hands of Reggie as we moved throughout West Africa. The following year, when we had the conference in 86, the following year, we called for a pilgrimage to Africa, to the Nile Valley in 87. And because of Reggie's experience the year before, he was asked to lead a group of almost 150 people of the 800 that went. And they came by way of Air Jordan. They had to go through Jordan in order to come into the Nile. I led the Air Maroc group that included Regent Adelaide Sanford, Naeem Akbar, Wade Noble's son, etc. And we came through across the Africa, across the Sahara, and then into Egypt. Dr. Reginald Mabry has earned his degree at the highest levels of learning and implementing the knowledge and making it real. And that has to be understood.
Who are we talking about?
We're talking about Antoine. And Antoine is his middle name. He doesn't want us to deal with that. But his mother and father, Antoine, up from Virginia, named him.
Let's get back on
Mabry. It's important for people to know that your life was transformed a couple of years before. It could have been a different Reggie. You got into the African mix with us and into this deep knowledge, and we put responsibility on you that we should have said, wait a minute, you're too young to handle this. But we said, no, we were laying the groundwork for you taking a leadership and being prepared to deal with these struggles you now face. And so we're giving you, and we gave you, the master's and the doctorate in this deep understanding. 1,000 people went to the Nile Valley. And because of that, we almost had to go to war in the Nile, because we didn't want to go to Cairo, where everybody holds their international conferences. Dr. Ben said we need to go south into the deep into the Black Land, into Aswan. And so we had it in Nubia. And because there were so many of us, we had 40 or more buses. So it was like a train of white buses moving through the countryside. Because we had this high technology coming from modern Negroes that we are, we had walkie-talkies to hook up each bus. And because we had all of this technology, the walkie-talkies and the frequencies that protect the Aswan High Dam from attack was messed with, and the Egyptians didn't know what was going on, so they called Washington to find out what was going on, and come to find out that some Negroes were there with their high technology, and we became more than just an intellectual enterprise, we became a political enterprise, because the Cairo Egyptians were afraid that the Nubians might revolt and ask for independence, and they were afraid that Africans from America would be leading the charge. And so they put us in check, but they wanted us so bad to be there, they put an army regiment around us. They kept us locked into the Nubian Center, but they wanted our money so that they put a banking establishment in the Nubian Center.
Mansa Musa.
And they wanted us to buy whatever we could, because they knew our woman. My mother went. My wife went. I had 3 generations. My nephews went. They knew that our women would buy the objects from the Nile Valley.